Who invented the internet? Well, it wasn't a single individual, but one of the key innovators is my next guest. He is also the keynote speaker at SC21.
Hi, Rich. I'm Vint Cerf. I'm Vice President and Chief Internet Evangelist at Google.
Vint, can you give us a little preview of what you'll be talking about in your keynote?
I'd be happy to. Originally, I proposed to talk about the interplanetary internet, and they said, no, we don't want to hear anything about that. Talk about digital humanities. And I said, great, I'd love to talk about that. You know, computers have become such powerful tools that we are able to apply them to a wide range of disciplines, not just the hard sciences. And so when you start thinking about text, for example, and you think about what computers can do with the text, we almost have a kind of x-ray glasses that let us stare deeply into written material and discover associations, relationships, trends, other kinds of indicia. For example, with enough machine learning mechanisms and absorption of existing texts or known texts, we may be able to identify an unknown text as having been authored by a particular party based on the other works that we've seen, the distribution of words that are used, the order in which they get used. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how we use computers as a way of discovering and exploring textual material. And I'll be looking at some other kinds of applications that fall into the general humanities space, including the challenge of preservation of digital content over long periods of time. We don't have vellum anymore. Well, we do, but we don't go around killing animals mostly to publish books. But we now do e-publishing. And the question is, how long is that going to last? So that's another topic I'll be talking about.
Well, it sounds like a very good reason to register for SC21. I wanted to talk to you about a little bit on the medical side of things, Vint. We're still in the midst of a changing pandemic. What kind of hope does HPC give you about a future where we aren't dealing with a pandemic?
Well, it's arguable that high-performance computing was our friend in the midst of this pandemic. Very early on, the sequence of the SARS-CoV-2 virus was known and published and shared widely on the internet. The second thing that happened, of course, is that in the run-up to this particular situation, we had perfected a lot of tools that allow us to figure out how to build the kinds of proteins or the kinds of mRNA sequences that will produce proteins that allowed some of the vaccines, like the Pfizer vaccine, to be constructed in literally jake time. And we produced the vaccine, I don't mean to take credit for it, others did, in less than a year. And that is without precedent and without question only achievable with the kinds of tools, computing included, that are now available at need. So supercomputing has been our friend in here. And now as we look forward and we imagine later kinds of pandemics, which will happen, they're kind of inescapable, we will have learned a great deal from our experience with the SARS-CoV-2 pandemic, the COVID-19 disease, in preparation for the possibility of another pandemic. And in the meantime, if this becomes endemic, which it certainly appears to, then we're going to have to do the same thing we have done with flu, which is to track the various species of virus that arise and prepare vaccines that can combat them on an annual basis.
The power of high-performance computing versus the laptop that I'm on right now is many orders of magnitude different, right? If you tried to do some of this stuff on conventional machines, you'd be talking years, decades?
Well, you wouldn't get anywhere at all because the amount of data that is often involved is so stupendous that you have to have literally big iron, so to speak, in order just to hold all the information that you're processing. But what happens with science typically is that as we have these theories and they make predictions and we do experiments to test whether the predictions come out right, But what happens is that we begin to learn to measure more and more and more accurately, more and more precisely, which means we get more and more data because we get higher and higher resolution, especially if you're thinking in visual terms. And the consequence of that is just huge amounts of data. And as certainly you're well aware of this notion of the Internet of Things, we have sensor devices scattered all over everywhere, billions of them. They will be generating data as well. And we want all of that data because we can use it to gain insight into physical dynamics of what's going on in the world. So you are, it's inescapable that you have to make use of supercomputers in order to manage usefully to process all that data and turn it into insight.
So to people who think things are getting a little bit too complicated, maybe high performance computing isn't the solution to many of our problems, how would you react to that?
Well, first of all, supercomputing is not the solution to everything. You know, neither is blockchain, despite the headlines that might lead you to think otherwise. The honest answer is that we have a lot of problems as a society, and some of them are very much political. And I don't even necessarily mean that in the partisan sense, but in the sense of people interacting with each other, having different views of things, concluding that different kinds of solutions are better. How do we struggle with the tussle in order to find common ground and common solutions? So we have a lot of work to do quite outside of the computing range if we're going to solve the problems that are facing our civilization today. And I mean this in the broadest sense. So that's everybody on the planet, not just one country or another.
So you have participated in previous SC conferences. Can you give us your take on why it's such an important gathering?
There are several things that typically happen at these conferences that I find stunningly refreshing. The first thing is that you learn what people have been able to do with the currently existing equipment. And you can take great pride in some of the accomplishments that people have shown us. Then the second thing you'll hear is, this is what we couldn't do. And of course, the next question is, do you know why you couldn't do it? Sometimes the answer is, yes, I needed, you know, another 15 petabytes of RAM running at 0.001, you know, milliseconds or microseconds or nanoseconds. But there may be a case where they say, I don't know. Or, you know, despite the number of processors I had available, I couldn't get all of them running at the same time because I couldn't figure out how to allocate the memory and the data and the processing in such a way that it could proceed in parallel. So when you hear about, I don't know how to do X, but if I did know how to do X, it would make a big difference. That's the thing you want to hear at these conferences because it sets especially graduate students off looking for dissertation topics that they can separate from the rest of the universe so they can reasonably have an expectation of finishing. So these are stimulating kinds of conferences in addition to opportunities to be awestruck by what we have been able to accomplish up until now.
When you mentioned students, I'm wondering if you would talk about your involvement with Gallaudet University and how technology has helped with people who may have challenges with hearing and seeing.
So, well, Gallaudet, of course, specializes in teaching for people with hearing impairments, and where they could be totally deaf, and they use signing, which is a very common practice at Gallaudet. So visual learning is very important, a very important theme in the Gallaudet pantheon. What they have learned, of course, is that providing visual information together with explanatory information, which is accessible, that is to say, signing, is really important. What we find is that lots of people appreciate the techniques that Gallaudet have pioneered for visual learning, independent of American Sign Language, simply because by organizing the information in a way that is readily assimilable, it's very helpful. Now, if you happen to be blind, then you have another problem because you can't see anything. And so how do you convey information to someone in oral form on the presumption they can hear, even if they can't see? That's not as much an attention item at Gallaudet as it might be for other places that are more focused on people with visual impairment. But I would say that companies like mine at Google are equally interested in all of these various kinds of challenges, because the question is, how do I adapt my software to be accessible to people with a variety of different challenges for which accommodation is required? How do you gain insight into knowing how to design programs that are really, truly accessible for everyone? And so Gallaudet contributes to that, as do others.
So I think we've covered the ground that I wanted to cover, but did you have something you wanted to say to this group of people who are on social media thinking about attending this conference?
Well, first of all, if you're thinking of attending the conference, it must be because you care a lot about computing at scale. And so what I find interesting are some of the newer technologies that are beginning to emerge. TensorFlow, for example, for large deep neural networks coming out of Google, among others. Things like quantum computing, which have not yet reached the point where they are actually productive, but they are hinting at what they could do. Certainly at Google, we've had some good experiments with our cryogenic quantum computing systems. And one of the biggest problems associated with quantum computing is that for every qubit needs to have at least two wires attached to it. You might need 1 million qubits in order to have 1,000 logical qubits in order to do error correction. But if you have 1 million physical qubits, that's 2 million wires. Let me tell you something, getting 2 million wires to connect to a bunch of things of any kind is hard. And so now you run into the problem, gee, maybe I can't do all 1 million qubits on one machine. What if I have to break it up into multiple machines? How do I connect the machines together in such a way that the entanglement property, which is key to quantum computing, is maintained across machines? And for that, you need quantum internet, which means you need quantum repeaters that will repeat photons and maintain their entangled property so that when they land at the next machine in the group, it becomes entangled with the one that sent that entangled photon. And so you can just imagine all the big challenges that lie ahead in trying to build large-scale quantum computing in an optical environment.
I think my friends who build the big Cynet network, which becomes the fastest network in the world for the week of the conference, are going to be happy that you mentioned this.
Well, I can tell you that it seems like this is a never-ending process, because every time we turn around, somebody may discover a new physical process through which we can do computation a different way. And by the way, I don't want to leave out one of the most important elements of all of this, and that's the diversity of computation devices is putting some real strain on the software side of this. What algorithms can we run? How should we express them? What languages should we use? How do we write compilers that are going to compile code for different kinds of processing elements as opposed to a uniform reduced instruction set architecture? What if we have quantum processors and we have TensorFlow processors and we have GPUs and we have CPUs and we have God knows what else? How do I write the software for that? And the answer is, I think we don't know yet. And I just spent 6 hours with the Department of Energy's Advanced Supercomputing Advisory Committee. And I can tell you that they surfaced not only a series of triumphant results, but a whole series of great challenges ahead.
Vint Cerf, thank you so much for being with us today, and thanks for giving us a preview of your keynote address at SC21.
Thanks so much, Rich. See you there.
And thank you to our viewers. Stay tuned for another edition of SC21 TV.